You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Boy, did I mess up that intro tonight. Had the regular broadcast going here on 101.1 FM Eager. Doing the uplink for the worldwide broadcast on WRMI. And I had plugged the earphones into the recording unit, but it was so loud that it was going to interfere with the uplink, so I pulled the phones out just a little bit. I forgot that we were playing music on 101.1 still, because I should have brought that pot down and taken that off the air. And I hadn't done it. And so the initial conglomeration of noise that you heard was the result of all of that, ladies and gentlemen. Operating this stuff is not as easy as it might seem. And we don't mess it up too often, but when I do, and I shouldn't say we don't mess it up, when I mess it up, I really mess it up. It's a good thing that I don't do that too often. Well, there's a bunch of news, folks, and some of it really, does pertain to all of us. The National Transportation and Safety Board issued a press release today stating that the condition of the worn wiring in the center fuel tank of TWA Flight 800 has sparked inspections on all the other aircraft of the same type in order to make sure that the wiring is not worn so that they can make sure that the same thing doesn't happen to any other aircraft that happened to TWA Flight 800. Now, that would give you the impression that they had found frayed wiring in the center fuel tank on TWA Flight 800, and that is what caused the explosion and crash. And that's just not true, ladies and gentlemen. It's not true at all. Number one, they didn't find anything wrong mechanically or with the wiring or with the electronic components or electrical components or mechanical components whatsoever surrounding or having to do with or in or connected to the center wing fuel tank on TWA Flight 800. They've already made that perfectly clear. And that was also made perfectly clear during the five-day hearings that the National Transportation and Safety Board conducted on the crash of TWA Flight 800. Now, I thought that this was an extremely misleading. In fact, it was intended to be it's intended to make the public think that the cause of TWA, the cause of the crash of TWA Flight 800 has been discovered. And it's intended to leave you with the impression that it was frayed wires in the center wing fuel tank. That's a bold-faced lie, ladies and gentlemen. I have no compulsions about saying that over the radio, and I can guarantee you that nobody's going to sue me because it's the truth. Because I've studied all of this. I tape recorded every single second of the entire week-long investigation board public hearing on TWA Flight 800. I have perused all of the documents and the release that are, a result of the investigation. I have waded through pages and pages and pages of the official National Transportation Safety Board publications on the results of their investigation so far. It's just a bold-faced lie. Now, right after they made this press release, they stated that they had not found the cause of the crash of TWA Flight 800. But you see, the way propaganda and disinformation works is the public will not hear that. All the public is going to remember is that they're making inspections of all of the different aircraft that are the same type as TWA Flight 800 in order to inspect for frayed wiring in the center wing fuel tank, such as that found in TWA Flight 800, which in fact was never found. And so that's going to mislead the public into thinking that was the cause of the crash. They don't have to worry about it anymore. It's all over. That's a bold-faced lie, ladies and gentlemen. The National Transportation and Safety, and if you don't believe me, you get a hold of the results of the investigation yourself, and you'll discover that they did not find anything wrong mechanically, electronically, electrically, anything connected with anything to do with that center-reading fuel tank. They have not discovered the cause of that crash. They have not discovered why the center-reading fuel tank blew up. And that is the truth of the matter. It's just like the thing with the anthrax in Las Vegas. You see, the great herds of sheeple out there, all they remember is that two men were arrested in Las Vegas with an anthrax biological weapon that was going to be used to kill tens, maybe hundreds of thousands of people. That's all they remember. They didn't listen to, and they do not remember that both of those men were exonerated. What they had was an anthrax vaccine. They were not planning to hurt anybody. They did not have an anthrax biological weapon or anything even remotely resembling it. And Mr. Harris, in fact, is a microbiologist who has been working for a long time to come up with cures for things like the Black Plague and anthrax. And if not cures, then what can the general public use that they don't have to go get a prescription for in order to vaccinate themselves or treat themselves should these plagues be introduced into the population as a result of a genuine terrorist attack, which we know is going to eventually come, simply because we know the agenda of international socialism and the New World Order. We know what they've got to do to bring it about. And so, it's just another one of those things, folks. Also, Marvin Kandel on CNN today said, he agrees with me. He said there's going to be a real major readjustment of the market. He says it's way overpriced, like I've been telling you for a long time, that it's got to correct and that it's got to fall. And he said it's going to fall in the near term, which means right around the corner. And that's, I think that's pretty strange considering that just within the last few days, I had posted a special alert for people on my on the webpage. And you can go there and see for yourself first. It's harvest-trust.org. What you hear there, if you hear it, is I'm plugging the laptop into the internet so that I can take a look at what's going on in the world just in case something has happened since the last time I looked that you might need to be told about. So anyway, Marvin Kandel on CNN has agreed with me because I have just recently, within the last 3 days, I think, posted a warning on the internet, on our webpage, that they get ready for another major market crash. It's not a correction. The market is in the process of crashing. Now, don't ask me why the New York Stock Exchange keeps going up and up in the face of the fact that the rest of the world is in absolute financial disarray. Their economies are in the pits. Now, I'm going to tell you something else that, wasn't covered here in the United States. You're not going to hear it. We're being fed so much propaganda, BS crap, that it's a wonder that Americans even have any brains left. Just the other day in Japan, the head of Sony, which could be considered to be a country itself, the chief executive officer of Sony Corporation said that Japan's economy is collapsing and is in fact in ruins. That's what he said. The entire economy of all of Asia hinges on the Japanese market. Now, I've been telling you this for months, ladies and gentlemen, that the markets and the economies of the world and the world trade are so interdependent and so intertwined now that whatever is going on in Asia or the rest of the world will have a ripple effect. I told you that it could take about a year to hit our markets and really affect them. And I posted that on our website way back before the fall October. In fact, I predicted that fall to the day, and said that that was the beginning of a worldwide economic collapse, and that it would take about a year for the ripple effects to hit the markets in the major industrial nations, including the United States of America. And I warned you all to get out of the market. Well, the market here is being supported by propaganda and lies, and it's phony. None of those companies, even remotely in your wildest dreams, approach the value of what the stock is selling for now. Can you imagine, ladies and gentlemen, in a year and a half, the market has gone up 3,000 points? Are you kidding me? Are you nuts? I'm telling you, when it finally hits the New York Stock Exchange, people are going to be so hurt. The companies in this country are going to just, it's going to be worse than the 1929 stock market collapse, ladies and gentlemen. Now, you don't have to believe me. Just like always, I'm telling you, listen to everybody, read everything, believe absolutely nobody unless you can prove it in your own research. But I can't help giving you this warning. I've got to give you this warning. If I don't, I will feel terrible for the rest of my life. It's coming down. It's a part of the socialist plan for creating the New World Order. They must have a total economic collapse around the world to institute a new economic world system. It's got to happen. And one of the planks of the Communist Manifesto is to eliminate the middle class. How else are they going to do it? It's got to happen. And last October, it started with the collapse of the Asian economies, which have never recovered and are still falling. You haven't even begun to see the real effect of that. When the chief executive officer of Sony Corporation makes a public statement in Japan. I mean, the Japanese just don't do this. I don't care who you are. You don't do this unless this such a tremendous catastrophe about to happen that you have no choice. The chief executive officer of Sony Corporation said that the Japanese economy is in ruins and that the whole thing is about to collapse. You better listen. Because I'm telling you, when it does, it's going to have a tremendous effect here. You know that it's already affecting the United States, and these dreamers out there that are putting their money into the New York Stock Exchange and the NASDAQ are just totally ignoring it. You know that our trade deficit now is the highest it's ever been in the history of the United States of America? Oh, my goodness, folks. And you listen to Clinton tell you how great the economy is. There's no problem. And the government's not in any financial danger. He talks about balancing the budget and the deficit between government spending and what has been allotted by Congress is the lowest it's ever been. But he doesn't talk to you about the trade deficit, and he doesn't talk to you about the real debt of the United States of America, which is so high that no matter how much taxes they take in, ladies and gentlemen, from any source whatsoever, they can't even meet the interest payments, much less make payments on the principal in order to shrink that debt. It's not happening. There's going to be a tremendous catastrophe. It's going to be economic in nature. It's going to be the trigger that pulls down this country and causes people to get down on their knees and beg for some kind of relief, and they're going to give it to you. They're going to give you the relief, all right. It's going to be in the form of a shaft. You're all going to get shafted is what's going to happen. But don't believe me. I mean, who am I? I don't know nothing from nowhere, from nobody. I am just, you know, some dummy here on the radio. Well, let's get on to something else. You all heard about the face on Mars and the great external threat to the Earth from the extraterrestrials. Whether they've been presented to you as a threat or not, ladies and gentlemen, the fact that somebody from somewhere else had such an advanced technology that they could get here, constitutes a threat, whether they present themselves as a threat or not. They have definitely been presented to us as a threat. Have you been paying attention to all this baloney, this crapola about alien abductions and the UFO thing? Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's all a hoax. The biggest hoax ever perpetrated, most probably, upon the people of the world, in order to create an external threat to the earth to hasten the or facilitate the formation of world government, so that all humanity will be, propelled to come together in order to face that threat and make whatever sacrifices necessary. And at the same time, of course, it would be touted as the most significant event in the history of humanity. And one of the things that has been foisted upon the people of the world is that there's a face on Mars, and there's pyramids, and there's a city on Mars, and all this. It's baloney, folks. It's a lie. It's not true. Now, the Mars orbiter, the surveyor that's up there right now, or at least they say it's up there, we have to take their word for it because we can't really tell, sent back pictures of the Cydonia region of Mars where this Mars face is supposed to be located. And these photographs were posted to the NASA pages on Monday. Well, today is Tuesday, and we have posted the best of all of the pictures to our website. And you can clearly see that there is no Mars face. It's a natural rock formation. It is plain to anybody. But let me tell you what's going to happen. These Illuminati socialists and intelligence community change agents are going to put these pictures on computers, and they're going to manipulate with these pictures with a computer, which anybody can do. I can do it myself. I can take the picture, put it on a computer, and make it look like anything I want to. I can make it look like my grandfather if I want to. Well, they're going to make a face out of it. And when they make a face out of it, they're going to tell you that it is absolutely confirmed that there is a face on Mars. But if you go to our webpage right now, or the NASA pages, if you think that I'm fooling with you, you'll see the same pictures there on the NASA pages, and you'll see that it is nothing more than a natural rock formation. No joke, folks. You can see it with your own eyes. It's no face. It's mountains, and looks like what at one time could have been erosion due to water and rain and maybe wind. Just all of that. It's just a normal. It's a bunch of rocks in rills and mountains and things. And there's no mistaking it whatsoever. Anybody who looks at that and says that it was made by intelligent beings and that it's a face is not playing with a full deck of cards, folks. It just is not playing with a full deck of cards. That's all there is to it. So you can go to our website. In fact, you should go to our website. If you have a computer and access to the internet, you should be on our website all the time, because literally, if you went on our website tonight and did nothing but spend time on our website and on the links that are connected to our website from our website, ladies and gentlemen, you could literally spend a few months there, 24 hours a day. That's how much information that we have made available for you. And we're linked to everything of any importance in the whole world. Every secret society link that's on the webpage is on our website. There are links to every newspaper, magazine, broadcast source of news, everything that you can dream of that you could possibly want in order to acquire information, you can go to directly from our webpages. Every military homepage, Army, Navy, Marines, Air Force, Coast Guard, the FBI, the Central Intelligence Agency, National Security Agency, every agency of government, I mean every single one of them, every major database in the United States and some in the rest of the world are linked from our web pages. So, and we have some forums, folks. We have a forum called Voices, where you can get into discussions with other people, leave your comments, result of your research. You can learn an awful lot from some of these other people who have done extensive research and are always putting the results of it in the Voices forum. We also have a chat room, which in the busiest time is usually between 8 p.m. and midnight every night. And I'm talking probably Central Time, or maybe I should say it's that time would probably apply to Mountain Standard Time. I'm sorry. So between 8 p.m. and midnight Mountain Standard Time, that's when the chat room is the busiest. If you check in at 8 and there's nobody there, check in at 8:30 and then again at 9. I guarantee you it fills up, and there's some pretty awesome conversation goes on there with some pretty intelligent people. And there's also a lot of humor and fun and all that kind of stuff. So if you're interested in that kind of thing, you can certainly find it on our webpage. Once again, it's harvest-trust.org. That's harvest-trust.org. One more time, just for those of you who might be a little unprepared, harvest-trust.org. It's one of the busiest web pages on the entire internet. We went online with our web pages on August the 25th, ladies and gentlemen, of 1997. In just this short period of time, we've had 1 million visitors to the website. And every month, it keeps going higher. In other words, the first month, we had 5,600 visitors. Next month, we had about 60,000 visitors. Next month, it was 90,000, and then 110,000. And this month, already, folks, in the month of April, we've already gone over 50,000 visitors to the website, and we're only 7 days into the month. So we'll probably hit over 300,000 visitors to the website this month, the month of April. It has become the place to find information of every kind that you can think of. There's a link, ladies and gentlemen, from our website to every website in the nation having to do with police departments, police training, police officers, police databases. If you want to find another police officer that works in the United States, you can do that right there. We've got a list of subversive organizations, and the organizations listed there would really surprise you. We've got all of the Charters of Freedom, the original documents, the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution for the United States of America, the Magna Carta, and many, many more on our website. You can see the actual original documents just as if you went to Washington, D.C. and stood right in front of them and pressed your nose against the case and got as close as you could. Well, folks, on our website, you can get even closer than that. With your own computer, you can magnify them and examine them to the nth degree if you want to. And in case you have trouble reading the sort of archaic writing that our founding fathers used, we have full text, exact duplicates, including the punctuation and capital letters that are in the originals. We have an intelligence link. From that link, you can go to the homepage of every intelligence agency, intelligence organization, military intelligence, private intelligence, government intelligence that there is. We have an Internal Revenue Service webpage, and the information that you'll find there will just knock your socks off and make you mad as hell when you find out how these scum-sucking, puke-faced socialists, jackbooted Nazi thugs have been destroying people's lives for all of these years. They destroy businesses. They destroy families. They put parents in jail and separate them from their children and take their children and scatter them all over the country in I forget what you call it, some kind of volunteer homes where they're where they're subjecting the children to all kinds of psychiatric examinations and giving whoever takes them in extra money for putting up with them, and causing a lot of people to commit suicide, and they never recover from this. Their lives are ruined, just completely ruined. When you find out the truth about the Internal Revenue Service and what they've been doing, well, then, folks, you're going to be pretty angry. I know I was when I first discovered it many years ago. We've got links to micro-broadcasting so that you can figure out how to put up your own micro-broadcasting FM intrastate, that means within the state, non-commercial radio station. And as long as you stick to the rules that you find there, you should be okay. And the FCC has admitted it, finally, that they have absolutely no control or authority over any lawful micro-broadcasting radio station in this country, ladies and gentlemen. In fact, the FCC, by their own regulations, doesn't license or control anybody below 100 watts who is engaged in intrastate, non-commercial broadcasting, such as 101.1 FM Eager and other micro-broadcasting stations all across the United States of America. And now, since they don't have any control over these people, they're not busting them or citing them for broadcasting without a license anymore. You know what they're doing? They're going through the radio bands and they're finding the stations that don't have good low and high pass filters, and they're busting them for interfering with other licensed broadcasters. Which is, of course, against the law. And nobody should be interfering with any other signal of any other broadcaster, whether licensed or unlicensed. It doesn't make any difference. But it's the truth, folks, that if you read the Constitution, it becomes clear to you. It's very simple. The Constitution tells you what powers the government has and what powers the government does not have. It tells you what they can regulate and what they cannot regulate. And any attempt to regulate or take powers or use powers beyond those given to it by the Constitution is unconstitutional, unlawful, is in fact criminal. That's right, I said criminal. And there are an awful lot of people within government operating under the color of law who are in fact criminals. 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 A lot of them don't even know it, because they're hired, they go to work, they don't know beans about anything, they go to these little training sessions where their supervisors train them to do these things, they're not told that what they're doing is unlawful, none of them get the law, the statutes, the United States Code, or the regulations, none of them research the delegations of authority from the Congress and from the cabinet member all the way down to their position to find out if they really have that authority. They're trusting their supervisors to tell them the truth, and they're not. They're just simply not. And they're no different from the rest of you. They never read the Constitution either. You think just because they work for government, they've read the Constitution, you think they're any better than anybody else? You think that they're any more responsible than anybody else? No, they're not. They're just people like everybody else. They just happen to have a government job. They're just like everybody else. They do as little as possible and get away with as much as possible. All the time accepting the paycheck of their employer and at the same time complaining and usually cursing or their employer or you know, otherwise downgrading the person that they've agreed to do the work for. That's the way most people are. Not all, but most. Most people are exactly that way. And so they don't take any extra pains to look and see if they're really doing the right thing under the law. No, that's work. And if they don't have to, they're not about to do it. So it's very easy for somebody who gets in a position of power in government, who's a part of these secret societies and these hidden agendas who want to subvert the nation, to get those working under them to go right along with it with no problem whatsoever. It is easy. If you don't believe me, get some young person that wants to be a police officer. Follow him around if you can. I know that most of you can't do this. But if you could, follow him around. Right through police academy, right into the police department, right out on the job, and watch what happens to that young man or that young woman who starts out wanting to serve their community, starts out wanting to serve the law, wanting to help people. And watch what happens to them. You'll reach a point where you'll see them beginning to break the law. In the performance of their duties, on instructions from their superiors, and they won't even know it, they'll believe that they're doing the right thing and they're doing it with the proper authority and that they have the right to do it. And at some point, they'll reach a mental state of mind where the public becomes the enemy. And the only ones they can trust or associate with are other police officers. Now, if you find a police officer who will tell you the truth, who's honest, and you ask him these questions, he'll tell you that that's exactly right. That's the truth. Even though in their own mind, they still really want to do the Now, if you find a police officer who will tell you the truth, who's honest, and you ask him these questions, he'll tell you that that's exactly right. That's the truth. Even though in their own mind, they still really want to do the right thing. Guess what happens to these people? They reach a point, ladies and gentlemen, and I'm not picking on police. This could be any government job you can think of. Any one that you can think of. They reach a point where they're not singling. They met Susie. And they got married. You know Susie the cheerleader? Well, they met Susie the cheerleader. They got married. And guess what happened next? They had 2.5 children. And guess what happened next? They bought a house. And then what? Well, they had to have an extra car because, while Joe police officer is out working with the police car, Susie's got to have something to drive. So they get a car. And then later on, one of their children gets to be 13 or 14, and they've got to have a car, so they get another car. And they have to have furniture and all kinds of stuff. And eventually, you know, the old Joe police officer would be sitting there, and he needs a boat to go fishing with. And he couldn't do the right thing if he wanted to, because that's his job. That's the only thing he knows by that time. He doesn't understand yet, and some people never understand, that he has the same brain as everybody else in the world and could get another job doing anything he wanted to, and even better yet, could start his own business and be his own boss using the brain that God gave him. But you see, that requires risk and work. And he's comfortable by now. He's getting a good paycheck. He's had a couple of promotions. And he's in debt up to his ears, and he's looking at putting 2.5 children through college. And there's Susie. Remember Susie the cheerleader? There's Susie telling him, don't do anything to jeopardize your paycheck. Don't do anything to jeopardize my security. If you do, I'll divorce you and rah, rah, rah. Happens all the time, folks. And everybody listening to this broadcast knows it. That's how you get trapped. That's how you get trapped, and that's how you get sucked in to performing a life of disservice. And don't go off the deep end and think I'm picking on people. I'm talking about the truth, about the human condition, and how the people who want to subvert this country use our frail humanity against us. They know how to do this. And if you've got a copy of my book, Behold a Pale Horse, and you've read Chapter 1, Silent Weapons for Quiet Wars, it spells it out in there so that even a first grade child can understand how we're manipulated through our human weaknesses. We all have these weaknesses. And geniuses who know how to exploit that can manipulate us. by twanging the strings of our humanity. So I'm not picking on anybody. It just happens to be that I'm giving you an illustration of how these things happen and how people get trapped doing things they didn't start out to do. They never wanted to do in the first place. And they still really don't want to do, but now they've got to do it in order to survive. Why do you think they had the phony oil shortages in the 70s? And then again in the beginning of the 80s? It's been proven that there was no oil shortage. But prices went up. The price of homes went up. Salaries stayed basically the same. And so instead of the man going to work and being able to provide for a family of five, including himself, comfortably on his salary back then, now he can barely make it with him and the wife and the children all working. These things don't happen by accident. Inflation is not an accident. It's never caused by the shortage of oil or plastic or anything else. Inflation is caused by printing more money, by making more credit available, by flooding the economy with easy money. That's what causes inflation. The more money you flood into the economy, the more money the economy needs. Inflation fuels off of itself. The oil shortage was just the excuse to do it. They've got to destroy the middle class. They really took a big chunk out of everybody when they did that. Oh, yes. Now, if we had lawful money, as defined by the Constitution, that could never have happened. Could never have happened. Would never have happened. You see? If you look around today, ladies and gentlemen, and you look at the situation in the colonies right before the revolution that created this country, you'll see that, according to history, ladies and gentlemen, the fact that a revolution has not happened is absolutely incredible. The colonists were angry about a little bitty tea tax. At least that's the excuse we're told today. Truth is, it wasn't about the tea tax at all, although that helped fuel the fire. It was really about the Bank of England telling the colonies that they could not handle their own money. That it all had to come from the Bank of England. That they couldn't manage their own money. That they couldn't create their own money. That they couldn't have a booming, good economy. It had to be debt-based from the Bank of England. That's really what caused the revolution back then. But for all you people who really believe it was the tea tax and a few other little things that history books talk about, if that's the truth, then we are pretty sorry descendants of those people. Because you have to work for about 6 months now just to break even with all of the taxes that you think you have to pay. Now, don't get me wrong, a lot of them are lawful and constitutional taxes. A lot of them aren't. Can you imagine that? Working for 6 months just to break even to the point where you can work for the rest of the year, and hopefully if you work hard enough and long enough, come out a little bit ahead? Well, who actually comes out ahead? Look around in your neighborhood, folks. You know a lot of people. But don't be fooled because somebody looks like they're wealthy. If you see somebody with a real big, beautiful house, and you think they've got a wonderful job, and their wife is working too, and they've got a boat and an RV, don't let that fool you, folks. Those people aren't rich. They're in debt up to their ears. And any minor catastrophe, they could lose every bit of it. Every bit of it. So all you people running around and look at somebody who's really got a bunch of stuff, believe me, every time they get their paycheck, by the time they get through paying all of the payments and interest that's piled up on all of that stuff, they just got a little bit left over to put food on the table. And that's the truth. If you don't believe me, if you don't believe me, folks, see if you can get one of them to let you, you know, sit down with them when they're going through their monthly chore of balancing all of this stuff. It's the truth. Most Americans are so in debt that regardless of what you think they have, if they were to sell every single possession that they own, most Americans would not have $2,000 left in their hands. In fact, most Americans would be in the red if they would still owe money after having sold everything that they have. They would still owe money. Any catastrophe, the loss of a job, the unexpected, and the loss of a job is always unexpected, ladies and gentlemen. Why do people put themselves in positions like this? It used to be in this country that good people did not go into debt unless it was absolutely necessary, that there was no way that they could keep from it. They would scrimp and save their money if they wanted to purchase something. And then they would go purchase it when they had the money. Now, instead of saving $500 to buy something that somebody wants, they'll go out and purchase it on credit, or they'll get a loan from a finance company or a bank or somebody, and they'll go buy it. And you know what they end up spending after they paid the interest? Not $500, but $650 or $700 and sometimes even $800, depending on the interest that came along with that loan. And if you have credit cards, you could be paying as high as 30% interest on what you purchased with those credit cards. Smart people don't have credit cards. Some people have credit cards because they think they have to, or they should, because somehow it makes them a better person. And the smart people who have credit cards get the ones that don't have any yearly payment, or yearly membership fee is really what it amounts to. And there's a grace period of like 30 days. If you make the payment on whatever you purchase within 30 days, then there's no interest. Well, if you're going to do that, folks, why didn't you just wait 30 days so you had the money and buy what you got to buy? Why use that piece of plastic? Because sooner or later, you're not going to be able to make that payment within 30 days, and you end up paying that 30% interest or 15% interest or however much interest it is. And don't be fooled by these things that they send you. They'll send you a credit card and a little statement saying, here's your credit card, we have pre-approved you, and here's your credit card, we're sending it to you in advance, and you're only going to be charged no membership fee for the first year and only 5% interest. And they don't read the fine print. It's 5% interest for 3 months, or maybe 6 months if they're lucky. And then it jumps way up, and they don't realize it because nobody reads the fine print. Do you know anybody that reads the fine print? Well, I got to tell you, folks, a few people do, but they're very, very, very few. Most people get that credit card in the mail and they go, whoopee, I got my credit card. Wow, I didn't even know. Whoa, what a surprise. I'm going to rush right out and buy something. And that's what they do. You want to know why prices are so high? You want to know why things keep getting worse financially instead of better? It's because every time somebody gets a new credit card and they run out and use it, that's putting money into the economy that doesn't even exist. It's inflation. Every time you borrow money and spend that borrowed money, that's inflation. You have put money into the economy that does not exist. That's why. Wasn't an oil shortage. It's everybody running around borrowing money, using credit cards, using credit, charge accounts, all of this kinds of things. Eventually there comes a time where it has to have an adjustment, and the adjustment is inflation. Price of everything goes up, salaries stay basically the same. Who suffers? You do, sheeple. And who should suffer? You should suffer because you're the ones who did it. Why do I say you and not us? Because I don't have any credit cards. I don't have any debt. I don't owe anybody anything. Period. That's why. I don't say us because it doesn't apply to me. Now, if you want to talk about my past history, that's a different story. For most of my life, I was just as ignorant and stupid and was just as much a sheeple as anybody else that lives in this country. I woke up. I took a look around, I smelled the coffee, and I said, I am not going to contribute to the destruction of this country anymore. I'm going to do everything in my power to help wake other people up, so that my children might, just maybe, if I'm successful, just maybe might have some kind of a good future instead of that that's slated for them. Want to know what else was on the news today? Guess what they want to do, folks? They want to do away with the Social Security system as you know it today. Social Security is not Social Security, never was. It's a trap. It's a trap. When it was instituted, a lot of people quit saving their money for their old age because they thought the government was going to take care of them because the government was taking so much out of their paycheck every day for their Social Security. It didn't happen. My grandmother, when she finally caught on in her old age, was just absolutely devastated when she figured it all out. Not only that, when they first implemented Social Security, everybody was afraid that that number was going to be used for everything in the world and be used against them. They were told that the number could never be used for anything but Social Security. What a lie! The government just flat lied. Now you can't do anything without your Social Security number. They won't even let you get a motel room in most places. You see how it works? It's not Social Security, never was. They keep talking about this mystical trust fund. All of the trust funds maintained by the United States of America are codified in the United States Code. They're all listed. Every single one of them. Ladies and gentlemen, anybody can go to the law library and get the United States Code and look up all of the trust funds maintained by the United States of America. There is no Social Security trust fund, never has been, never will be. If you read the law and the United States Code that implements the Social Security Administration, you will see that it is just another tax. All of the money goes into the general fund. There is no trust fund. There never has been. And so when Congress takes the money belonging, supposedly belonging, to the Social Security and uses it for something else, they're not doing anything wrong. When the president takes money from Social Security and uses it for something else, he's not doing anything wrong. He can do that with anything that's in the general fund. And Social Security is lawfully and constitutionally in the general fund. There is no Social Security trust fund, never has been. When these people talk to you about the Social Security trust fund, they're either repeating something they've heard from somebody else, or they're just telling you a bold-faced lie. Don't believe me? Look it up. Look in the United States Code. If you have a computer, you can go online to the United States Code, do a search for trust funds. You'll find all the trust funds administered by the United States listed, all within the law, and you can go through them till you're blue in the face. You can go through them for 1,000 years. You will not find a Social Security trust fund. There isn't any. But now they're manipulating you again. They're lying to you. They're telling you that to save the Social Security trust fund, they want to stop taking your money out. They want you to take your money and invest it. Now, you know about that, don't you, folks? First time you need a few extra dollars, guess what's going to happen to your Social Security investment? And guess what's going to happen to you when you get old? when there's nothing there. Now, this doesn't apply to everybody because there's a lot of people who are saving for their old age and have investments and things right now, trying to take care of themselves because they're smart. But most people won't. Most people won't do it. But they're going to bite on this because they're going to make it look attractive. And they may even have some plan to where they'll do it for you. Invest it into private investment funds so that you can have a whole bunch of money when you retire and do whatever you want to do with it. The problem with that, ladies and gentlemen, is they're getting ready to pull the plug on this stock market and they know it. If you read the comments and the real reports that come out of Wall Street about what's happening in the third world nations and stock markets that began last October in the Far East, they know that this stock market is going to come tumbling down. They want to get as much of your money in there as possible so that they can suck it right out when it does. Because those people in the know never lose whether the stock market goes up or down. When they know it's going to go down, they'll sell short. When they sell short, they are sucking your money out of the stock market into their pockets. There isn't any Social Security trust fund. Nobody needs Social Security. Everybody should be taking care of their own old age. People who rely on Social Security to do it are disappointed when they grow old because there isn't any money there. What little money is there does not support anybody. If you don't believe me, go find some old folks on Social Security and sit down and talk to them seriously about how big their Social Security check is and what it pays for and what it buys. And then walk around town and look at the prices for rentals and for food and for restaurants and for cars and for everything else. If you rely on Social Security, you're going to be very poor in your old age. If you're not relying on anything, who's going to take care of you in your old age? If you're not responsible enough to take some money and put it aside and put it into safe and secure, not risky investments, so that you will really have some money when you get old to take care of yourself. If you can't do that, then how is this supposed to work when you're supposed to be able to make your own investments with your Social Security money? You know, sometimes I feel like I'm talking to a whole nation full of children. And I look back in my life and I can't get really, you know, I get disappointed sometimes. And sometimes I can't help it, I even get angry. But then I look back at my own life when I was just like everybody else. And I understand exactly how it happens. I understand where you're at and I know. Just like I didn't think anything was wrong, you don't either. I know that. And folks, when I was in that situation, I was the biggest child of all. Totally trusting, totally fooled, totally manipulated. Seems like so long ago. In fact, it seems like a dream, to tell you the truth. It really does. But it's not. It's the truth. I can remember going off to Vietnam to fight a war, thinking that I was being a great patriot and doing what my ancestors before me had done in fighting for their country. Protecting and defending the Constitution. What a fool I was. How stupid. Later on in life, I finally figured it out, realized Vietnam didn't have a darn thing to do with the United States. There had never been a threat from communism. Never, folks. That the Warsaw Pact was formed under the Security Council of the United Nations, just like NATO. And they weren't really enemies. They just made it look like we were enemies in order to tax us to death, to create technology that nobody would be able to rebel against in the coming New World Order. They were experiments in social control. And boy, they learned an awful lot. And I hope you've learned a little bit from this broadcast. Folks, don't think I'm talking down to you. Please don't do that. Don't think I'm putting myself up on a pedestal. I would be the first one to fall off if we were all put on pedestals. I just know a lot that you haven't learned yet. And I don't know any other way to give it to you than just straight up and honest. Good night. And God bless each and every single one of you.
All of a sudden, in the middle of the night, there's a loud knock on your door. Behind, something's not right.
Draw out your arms. Let the Templar pass through. We're here from the government. We're here to help you.
And I'm from the IRS with a powered attack. If you've got a complaint, think of the fact.
Get out of this house. Hold your guns. Give me your guns. And then obey if you want to hold. Now produce that and do what you're told.
President Clinton just signed an executive order outlawing 58 new firearms that were never outlawed before. Doesn't that make you curious? How does the president get the authority to write law? Think about that. I thought we had a balance of power, executive, legislative, and judicial. Well, we don't. Not anymore. It's all executive, whether you know it or not. And we'll talk about that maybe a little bit tomorrow.
Clinton's preparing it for another huge pack. Hike. Order out of chaos, depression, inflation, creates a panic that rapes the nation. Crisis creation. In fight, black and white, program agitation.
Don't be fair. You're surrounded by the UN in white and brown, the ATF, the men in black, of the One World Order.
But it's not new. Iron Mountain, computer beasts, and cattle mutilation. Black projects, UFOs, and weird genetic combinations. The Nazi doctors didn't die. Come on, get him. They came here with the OSF, your Operation Paperclip. National ID, debit card? Yeah. Vaccination biochip, milk carton kits, genetic engineering. Clinton says her health plans for you and your own good. Sure. And Adolf Hitler's Robin Hood.
For who?
The sonic mind manipulation, inciting riots, is crisis creation. Biochip implantation, vaccinate your kid for UN identification.
Taking a test for all of us. So I have today just one simple request. A comprehensive package of healthcare benefits that are always there and can never be taken away. Never be taken away.
Atmospheric, social illusion, media hype, plan confusion.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you'd like to retrieve the information used on tonight's broadcast, go to http://harvest-trust.org. You're listening to the Worldwide Freedom Radio Network. Stay tuned now for all oldies most of the time. Classic radio, like you always wished it could be. Only the very best of the very best music of generations gone by.
Come back and knock.